Okay, from the calculus of variation to the number theory, Professor Carlo Viola of the University of Pisa speaks about on Lagrange's contribution to the theory of numbers. Please, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So I am pleased of this invitation, naturally, I'm very honored. So I will try to give you a general idea of what Lagrange did in number theory. And with respect to the calculus of variations, as we learned from Professor Giaquinta's lecture, the activity of Lagrange in number theory is definitely later. So as far as we know, there is essentially no contribution to number theory or to algebra by Lagrange in the Turin period, in the period when he was in Torino. And Lagrange's contributions to both algebra and number theory are concentrated in a rather short period, in fact, approximately from 1768 to 1775, during the years he was in Berlin. As Professor Giaquinta said, he was in Berlin for 21 years, and he occupied at the Academy of Sciences of Berlin, founded by the King of Prussia, Frederick II, a place which was left by Euler, who spent 25 years in Berlin and moved in 1766, moved to again to St. Petersburg. There are a few isolated contributions by Lagrange in number theory, which I will speak about maybe later in this talk. The most important of which are the so-called four squares theorem, stating that every positive integer is the sum of at most four squares. This was a famous problem raised by Bachet and Fermat and so on, but proved first by Lagrange. And another important contribution, which cannot be classified in the sense that I will speak about in a few minutes, is the so-called Wilson theorem, which was stated by Wilson but not proved by Wilson, saying that for every prime number p, the congruence, the p minus 1 factorial, is congruent to minus 1 mod p. This holds. In fact, holds if and only if p is a prime number. This is Wilson's theorem, which Lagrange proved first, was the first to prove. But apart from these two interesting theorems and a few more, I think that, as far as I can understand, all the contributions by Lagrange in algebra and in number theory are motivated by a sort of deep common interest, which is very much in the tradition of, first, of the Italian algebraists of the 16th century, like Cardano, Scipione del Ferro, and so on, and by Fermat. The Italian algebraists of 16th century plus Fermat are essentially the ancestors of what really is of interest to Lagrange in algebra and number theory. There is also a deep exchange between him and Euler, in a rather friendly way, I would say. So, in some sense, as opposed to what Giaquinta said about the calculus of variation, and more specifically to the minimal action principle, not only Lagrange acknowledged the enormous contributions of Euler in number theory, but also vice versa. Euler was very interested all the time, during years, in Lagrange's contribution to number theory, and there is a deep exchange between these two great men on the number theoretical results. Going back to Lagrange, Lagrange is motivated essentially, apart, as I said, for a few isolated results, is motivated both in his research in algebra and in number theory by a common interest, which is solving algebraic equations in all possible, very much in the tradition of Fermat and of the Italian algebraists of the 16th century. So, essentially, if I can resume this. Solving algebraic equations for Lagrange is essentially, can be described as a couple of main chapters in his research. One chapter is the solution, the quest for solutions of algebraic equations of this type, a polynomial of degree n equals zero, and interestingly enough, Lagrange always, when he considers this type of problems, always considers polynomial with real coefficients. As far as I looked at in Lagrange's work, he seems not to be interested in finding roots of this equation if the coefficients are complex. But of course, so he's interested in real coefficients, in real equations. And but of course he seeks also not only real roots but also complex roots. So he's interested in complex roots of real polynomials, essentially. So this is one main interest in Lagrange research in algebra. And again, this splits into two sub-interests. One is the quest for resolution formulae by radicals in the tradition of the Italian algebraists of the 16th century. And in other words, when the coefficients of the polynomial P are given not numerically but as letters, as symbols. And the other interest of Lagrange concerning this type of equations is how to find approximations of the roots, numerical approximations of the roots, in the case when the polynomial P is given by the coefficients of P are given numerically. So if C0, C1, and so on are given numbers, real numbers, how to find an approximation method for the roots of the polynomial. And another type of equations of algebraic equations that he is interested in is the Diophantine equations in two variables, or occasionally in more variables, P x y equals zero, where now P is a polynomial with integer coefficients, and the solutions that he seeks are integer solutions. So the adjective Diophantine means exactly this. So it's the search for integer or occasionally rational solutions of equations with integer coefficients, algebraic equations with integer coefficients. So 90% of the time he's interested in binary equations with two variables, two unknowns, x, y, integer or rational unknowns, and where the degree of the polynomial is 2. Occasionally, sometimes, he also considers this type of equations, of how to solve these equations, for polynomials of higher degree. An interesting aspect of Lagrange's results in this for this second type of problems is that Lagrange is very confident and optimistic about the fact that this type of problems should be tackled by the use of continued fractions. So it's sort of, if I may say so, with all the respect for Lagrange, it's a sort of obsession for him to use continued fractions in a positive sense, because continued fractions were considered, of course, by some predecessors of Lagrange, like Brouncker, Huygens, Wallis, and especially Euler. These authors obtained interesting results about continued fraction expansion of constants, of numbers, but not systematically. Euler, for instance, prefers to find here and there some nice results on continued fractions, the most famous of which is the continued fraction expansion for the number e, the basis of natural logarithms. And but Euler is not so interested in building a general theory of solving equations or treating Diophantine's problems based on continued fraction. This is a typical contribution of Lagrange. And, so Lagrange can be seen as the founder of the arithmetical theory of continuous fractions in a systematic way, and of the consequences for both Diophantine approximation and for solution of Diophantine equations of this theory, of the continuous fraction theory. In fact, the most famous result by Lagrange concerning continued fractions, as you probably all know, is the periodicity of the continued fraction expansion of quadratic irrationals. So he proved, Lagrange proved, that every quadratic irrational has a continued fraction expansion which is periodic, and this is the most important contribution of Lagrange to the theory of continued fractions. And so it's a posteriori more or less obvious that continued fractions are a very strong tool to solve Diophantine equations of degree 2, because it's a sort of the continued fraction algorithm is something which adapts very well to quadratic irrationals. But for instance, if I have an equation like this of degree 3, it's not so clear that the continued fraction algorithm is so important. But nonetheless, Lagrange is very optimistic about applications of solving Diophantine equations or approximating numerically solutions of equations like this with the continued fraction algorithm, independently of the degree. Now, Lagrange's production on these two subjects is contained in a large number of papers and culminates in three papers, three memoirs, which are the following. Réflexion sur la résolution algébrique des équations, published in 1770-1771, and this is one of the very important papers of Lagrange in concerning algebraic equations. Another very important memoir is the Addition à l'analyse indéterminée dans les éléments d'algèbre de Euler. So Euler published his algebra elements, and then under the request of Lagrange himself, In Lyon in 1773 there was a French translation of Euler's work. Euler wrote in Latin, and in fact in a very difficult and beautiful Latin anyway. So under the request of Lagrange, the algebra, elements of algebra by Euler were translated in French, and as an appendix, as an addition to the French edition of the elements of algebra by Euler, Lagrange published a long paper, 175 pages, as a supplement, I mean, of Euler's algebra elements. This is a very important paper because it's a sort of sum of synthesis of the work of Lagrange in the field of continued fractions and applications. So, in fact, Lagrange published a number of different papers on this type of problems, on continued fraction and applications, but they are essentially collect all the results, practically all the results by Lagrange in this field are collected in this addition à l'analyse indéterminée. A third extremely important memoir by Lagrange in number, and this is specifically, these two, the second and the third, are specifically in number theory, while the first is more in algebra. So another very, very important memoir by Lagrange in number theory is the famous Recherche d'arithmétique. This paper had an enormous influence on the research in arithmetical researches of Legendre, Gauss, and Dirichlet. By the way, Gauss published, as you know, his famous treatise on arithmetic, Disquisitiones Arithmetice, in 1801, and it's not by chance that the title of this very important work of Gauss is essentially the translation in Latin of this title by Lagrange, Recherche d'arithmétique. You can translate it as Disquisitiones Arithmetice. So, one thing which should be stressed is that the first and the third of these memoirs, Réflexion sur la résolution algébrique des équations and Recherche d'arithmétique, share a common feature, which is the fact of containing new ideas, which in the following centuries will lead to notions of abstract algebra. So for the first time, as far as I know, in the mathematical literature, there are notions of abstract algebra, or better, notions, ideas, which will lead to definitions of abstract algebra entities. And you can find them both in one and in three, here and there. In the first paper, Réflexion sur la résolution algébrique des équations, Lagrange studies, I will not go inside this topic because tomorrow we will have a lecture by Professor Chabert, supposedly, on this subject. So I will not go deeply inside, but let me just say a few words. In this Réflexion sur la résolution algébrique des équations, Lagrange studies the permutations of the n roots of an equation of degree n. This. And this study of the permutations of the roots is perhaps the most important contribution before Galois to the birth of the notion of group and to the forthcoming proof of the theorem of Ruffini and Abel about the impossibility of solving by radicals a general equation of degree greater than or equal to 5. So this is very important for the birth of the notion of group. And the recherche d'arithmétique, in this paper, in this memoir, Lagrange introduces a new approach to the treatment of the Diophantine equation So in Recherche d'arithmétique, Lagrange treats Diophantine equations of this type, a binary quadratic form in integer coefficients equal to a given integer, where the discriminant, of course, is not a square, and so where both the coefficients and the unknowns are integers. And the striking idea of Lagrange is not to consider just one equation and asking how to solve it, but to consider altogether all the quadratic forms, all the possible quadratic forms with a given discriminant D, fixed discriminant D, and introducing an equivalence relation, although the term equivalent will be introduced by Gauss, but essentially for Lagrange it's clear what is an equivalence relation. It's what we all know. It's the modern idea of equivalence relation. And the equivalence relation for Lagrange among such quadratic forms is to define a little f of xy equivalent to capital F of capital X capital Y, if and only if capital F is obtained from little f by applying to the vector capital X capital Y a matrix lying in the group GL2Z. So by making this homogeneous change of variables where the coefficients alpha, beta, gamma, and delta are integers with the determinant equals to plus or minus one. Because of course the inverse, if this holds, the inverse of this transformation is also the same type and with the same determinant. So this notion of equivalence had an enormous impact on the research, on the following research by Legendre, Gauss, and Dirichlet. And for instance, André Weil, in his work on the history of number theory, puts all the accent and André Weil's interest for the production of Lagrange in number theory is all concentrated in Les Recherches d'arithmétique, in this memoir. And he doesn't consider, he is not interested, in fact he says this explicitly, André Weil, is not interested for instance, in this memoir and other papers by Lagrange on the same subject, namely the study, in fact, even more than the study, the foundations of arithmetic theory of continuous fractions. This is something that Weil is not interested in, and of course everybody is free to be interested in whatever. I am personally interested in this because I think that Lagrange gave a really important contribution on this. And so I will, for the rest of my talk, I will speak a little bit on, I will avoid going deeply into this this paper because I suppose this will be the subject of Professor Chabert's talk. And I will instead give some more information about 2 and 3. The memoir 2, Addition à l'analyse indéterminée of Euler, represents the synthesis of several papers published by Lagrange during the years 1768-1773, mainly concerning the arithmetic theory of continued fractions with applications to both to Diophantine approximation and to solutions and to solving Diophantine equations. Lagrange's viewpoint on continued fractions and on these subjects, the deep motivation is the solution of Diophantine equations, but en passant, he also considers problems of Diophantine approximation, so how the continued fraction machinery is important to find rational approximations to irrational constants. And Lagrange's viewpoint on continuous fractions and application will be partially taken up by Legendre at the end of the 18th century. But I should say also that Lagrange is a predecessor very important research in the 20th century. So after, apart from something in Legendre, after Lagrange, the first important advances in Diophantine approximation and applications of this to the solution of Diophantine equations are due to Axel Thue at the beginning of the 20th century. Thue published a very important, in fact, no, sorry, the first one who gives new substantial contributions to the theory of Diophantine equations after Lagrange is Liouville in 1851, so in the mid 19th century. This Liouville's theorems are the first really important, really new contribution after Lagrange in this subject, and later on in the 20th century by Thue, Siegel, Roth, and so on. But it's interesting that all these advances, in some sense, can be considered as inspired by Lagrange, by Lagrange's work in continuous fractions and applications, but they are actually independent of the theory of continuous fractions. In other words, just to speak simply, Lagrange was extremely optimistic about the possibility of proving whatever using continuous fractions, but in fact this was impossible, essentially. So continuous fraction is a very keen, very deep tool in solving equations of degree 2 because of the Lagrange's theorem on the periodicity of the continuous fraction expansion for quadratic irrationals, but proved to be not so useful for solving Diophantine equations of degree greater than or equal to 3. And Lagrange was very optimistic. He thought that anyway the theory of continued traction would be relevant for this, but the development of mathematics afterwards showed that this was not the case. So all the advances in some sense inspired by the Diophantine approximation started by Lagrange were obtained by these great mathematicians like Liouville, Thue, Siegel, etc., but independently of continuous fractions. In fact, there is an interesting point in Lagrange's treatment of Diophantine equations of degree 2. So Lagrange solves, as a consequence of his theorems on continued fractions, Lagrange gives a complete solution of the so-called Pell equation, which is in fact due to Fermat, but has the common name of Pell's equation by an attribution by Euler. But anyway, Pell's equation is Pell's equation is the equation of x squared minus a y squared equals 1, where a is a positive integer, not a square. So the problem is finding integer points on a hyperbola like this, where a is an integer, a positive integer, and Lagrange is the first who proves, using his theory of continued fractions, who solves completely Pell's equation, so finds, shows, proves that for any positive integer a not a square, there exist infinitely many solutions in integer coefficients. And apart from the trivial solutions, plus or minus 1, 0, each solution, as Lagrange shows, with x and y positive, is such that x divided by y is a convergent in the continuous fraction for square root of a. And also he gives an algorithm, an explicit argument for finding among all the convergence of in the continuous fraction for square root of a, how to find those convergence which corresponds to solution of the Pell equation. So Lagrange's theory of continued fraction is perfect to solve Pell's equation, that is still used today, I mean, to describe the solution of this equation. And but there is a place in Lagrange's work where he seems to be, he mentions the problem of solving an equation of the type fxy equals m, more or less of this form. No. Yeah. Fxy equals to m, where f is not a quadratic form, but is a cubic form or a higher degree form. So what happens? So for this type of equations where f is a quadratic form, Lagrange gives a lot of theorems and more or less, almost not quite, but settles the problem of solving this type of equations. But what happens if in place of a quadratic form I write here a cubic form in x and y? And in a place in his work, Lagrange seems to believe that even if the degree of the form is three or more, there can be infinitely many solutions, at least for suitable A, B, C, and A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D, whatever. I mean, for suitable coefficients of a cubic form and for a suitable right-hand side here, Lagrange seems to conjecture that a cubic equation like this, similar to this, can have infinitely many equations. While by a famous theorem of Thue, if you put here a cubic form irreducible in the rationals, then necessarily the number of points xy with x and y integers solving the equation is finite. So the famous Thue's theorem for cubic equations of this type shows that Lagrange didn't have, in my opinion at least, the correct sentiment of what was the situation with cubic forms or higher degree forms. And this is, just to do a little psychology, this is probably because he was so confident about the importance of the continued fraction machinery even for higher degree equations, that he thought that probably somehow the using the technique of continued fractions, one should be able to prove that the behavior of higher degree equations like this is the same as quadratic equations like this, but this is not the case. According to Thue's theorem, every equation of this type with a cubic form, for instance, provided it's not reduced, is irreducible in rationals, necessarily has only a finite number of solutions. So there is a dramatic change from the degree 2 to the degree 3, which Lagrange didn't presumably, in my opinion, didn't even imagine. And So this is not to speak badly about Lagrange, but simply to stress the fact that he was so confident about the importance of his theory of continued fractions that he imagined that the same consequence as for quadratic equations might hold for higher degree equations of this type. All right, so let me write in a few lines the essential contributions of Lagrange in the continued fraction theory. So Lagrange considers what we call today simple continued fractions. In other words, continued fractions of this type with numerators all equal to 1 and where the partial quotients a0, a1, a2 are all integers with where a0 is the integral part of alpha. So if alpha is negative, a0 is also negative, while the other partial quotients a1, a2, and so on are strictly positive integers. These continued fractions, just for simplicity, is usually written in this form. So the partial quotients a0, a1, a2 are written on a line. And one of the striking examples of this type of continued fraction expansions is Euler's expansion for the number e, the basis of the natural logarithms. Euler proves in 1737 that E has this type, has exactly this continued fraction expansion. So when Lagrange was 1 year old, already this famous expansion, continued fraction expansion for E was known. And but I should say that this is a sort of very, very exceptional result. In other words, we know a lot about continued fraction expansions of rational numbers. If alpha is rational, if and only if this continued fraction terminates. And we know a lot by Lagrange's theorem proved in 1769 that alpha is a quadratic irrational if and only if the sequence of the partial quotients is periodic. And as far as other numbers are concerned, in other words, either algebraic numbers of degree greater than or equal to 3 or a fortiori, transcendental numbers, in general we know nothing about a continued fraction expansion. Up to a very few exceptions, which is essentially the number e and other numbers, other values of the exponential functions at suitable rational points, for instance, the nth root of e for any n, which should be thought of as sort of very exceptional situations. For instance, by Euler's expansion for E, we know a lot about the Diophantine approximation to the number E, but if you take, for instance, pi, another famous transcendental constant, we know essentially nothing about the continued fraction expansion of pi. So we cannot deduce from the continued fraction theory theorems of approximations to pi. Anyway, Lagrange is the founder of the modern theory of continuous fractions, and besides the definition here, which was known, of course, to Euler and others, he gives a systematic treatment of the various quantities connected with this expansion, which are the convergences, the fractions which are nowadays called the convergence to alpha, which are the continued fractions for alpha terminating at some point. So if you take the sequence of the partial quotients for alpha and you truncate the sequence at the level a n minus 1, you obtain all obviously a rational number. which is called a nth convergent to alpha, and which has striking properties of approximations. In other words, first of all, as Lagrange proves, the numerators and the denominators of this convergence, which Lagrange calls fraction principale, the numerator and denominators of this convergence satisfy a recursion with these initial values. Also Pn and Qn are automatically coprime because Pn Qn minus 1 minus Pn minus 1 Qn is minus 1 to the power n. Moreover, alpha minus Pn over Qn is always in absolute value is always less than 1 over Qn squared, and this is, as far as I know, explicitly stated in the mathematical literature for the first time by Lagrange, or at least clearly. I mean, Euler probably knew this, but Euler is always a little vague, so he's not interested in Euler in general is not interested in exhausting all the possibilities of a theory, so he lives, he writes things in a sort of non-systematic way in general. And which is what is even more important for the consequences for the applications is that the convergence coincide with the best approximations to alpha. In other words, up to a certain value for the denominator, Pn over Qn is the best possible approximation to alpha. In other words, Qn alpha minus Pn does not exceed Q alpha minus P for all rational number P over Q, where Q does not exceed Qn plus 1. So in other words, the distance of Qn alpha to the nearest integer Pn is a minimum when the denominator Q increases up to the following one, which will be Qn plus 1 alpha minus Pn plus 1, of course. So this is the concept of best approximation, which is used nowadays for in Diophantine approximation, and which, of course, gives a lot of consequences concerning the, as essentially is written here, concerning the rational approximations to alpha. This theorem was certainly known by Euler, although I don't know whether he explicitly states this, the fact that the fraction principale, the convergence, coincide with the best approximations. And in fact, this property seems to be more significant in Euler's work than in Lagrange. Lagrange is interested in applying these properties to the solution of Diophantine equations, while Euler seems to be more interested, although his style of writing goes from one subject to another, so it's not so easy to understand what was the main interest of Euler, because Euler is so immense. I mean, but altogether, I think that Euler was more interested in Diophantine approximations, so in properties, how to apply this type of properties for approximating irrational numbers by rationals, and Lagrange seems to me to be more interested in applications to the solutions of Diophantine equations. In his papers on continued fractions, which are summarized in the addition an analyse indéterminée of Euler, Lagrange considers also various generalizations of Pell's equation. So he solves completely Pell's equation, and then he is interested in generalizing this research for other Diophantine equations. So essentially for equations of the type of this type. Uh, However, he introduces this equivalence relation among quadratic forms only in his paper Recherche d'arithmétique and not in previous papers. So in previous papers he considers a lot of equations of second degree, of Diophantine equations of second degree, but essentially by generalizing step by step his results on Pell's equation. So he starts from his full solution of Pell's equation, then generalizes this to other quadratic equations. There is also a correspondence with Euler concerning a particular equation of Pell's type, but with a right-hand side, which is not 1, but is 101, I mean another integer. Like Euler conjectured that such an equation should be solvable, while Lagrange, using his theory of continued fractions, shows that the equation is in fact unsolvable. So there are a special equation of Pell's type has no solutions at all. And Les Additions à l'analyse indéterminée of Euler, he also treats a number of problems in solving Diophantine equations, and also, for instance, he applies the continued fraction theory to the search for the minimum of the absolute value of a binary form of any degree with integer coefficients. A further interesting application of continued fraction theory is obtained by Lagrange in another paper. Sur la résolution des équations numériques, published in 1769. This paper is mainly concerned with numerical approximation of the real roots of an equation P of x equals 0 of any degree n. In other words, what I wrote before. This problem here: how to find numerical approximation for the roots of an equation of this type, an equation that he calls équation numérique, because in the case the coefficients are given numerically, real coefficients. And Lagrange's method of treatment of this type of problem is very simple and very clever, and is a typical instance of his optimism about the theory of continued fractions. So since I am not a numerical analyst, I am not so sure that in practice this algorithm by Lagrange is efficient for finding numerical approximations to the solutions. But in any case, it's an interesting idea. So he observes that if there exists a root x of the equation between two consecutive integers, say a naught and a naught plus 1, then in the equation P of x equals 0, he makes the substitution x equals a naught plus 1 over x1. So he obtains a new equation, again of degree n, which is this one, which must necessarily have a root x1 greater than 1, corresponding to the root x here. So he transforms the... once he knows that a real root x of the first equation has integral part a zero, he obtains an équation transformée, another equation of degree n, which must have a root greater than 1. Then, if one, by studying, of course, the changes of sign of the polynomial, if one sees that there is this new equation has a root x1 which lies between two consecutive integers a1 and a1 plus 1, then he
he makes the substitution x1 equals a1 plus 1 over x2 in this equation, and then he ends up with an equation which must have a root x2 greater than 1, and so on. And thus, automatically, he obtains the continued fraction expansion for the root x of the first equation considered, of the initial root with the integral part a0. So it's a very nice and very, very simple algorithm. I don't know about the numerical efficiency of this, but in any case, and since continued fractions give you the best approximations from a Diophantine point of view of any number, so he automatically, with this finding successively the integral parts of the roots, a0, a1, a2, and so on, he obtains immediately a continuous fractional expansion for the roots, which could be, should be, in principle, numerically efficient. I think I have maybe 10 more minutes, no? Because something like that. Okay, so I cannot finish my lecture without my talk without giving more without speaking a little bit more about les recherches d'arithmétique, because of this extremely importance, both mathematical and historical, for the development of mathematics of this important memoir. So let me go back to this transparency. So this is the equivalence relation for quadratic forms, and how does Lagrange use this equivalence relation modulo the group GL2Z? Well, he first of all he proves sort of obvious thing that if F and capital F are two quadratic forms, binary quadratic forms with the same equivalent to each other, then automatically they must have the same discriminant D. And then he asks for the inverse problem. If I fix the discriminant D, what can I say about all the forms which have the discriminant D? Of course, if I take one form of discriminant D, all the equivalent forms to F, equivalent with F, have the same discriminant. The same discriminant, but not only one equivalence class has this discriminant. So for a given discriminant, I don't have just one class of equivalent forms with that discriminant, but several equivalence classes. So the problem, the inverse problem that Lagrange asks for is how to describe and possibly count the equivalence classes of forms having a given discriminant D. And here starts the contributions of Lagrange, which are very, very beautiful and very innovative. So first of all, Lagrange proves that every quadratic form of this type has an equivalent quadratic form reduced. Lagrange does not use the word reduced. This was introduced later by Gauss. Gauss calls reduced a form in the sense of Lagrange, which are the forms with integer coefficients capital A, capital B, and capital C, where capital B in absolute value is less than or equal to the other two absolute values of A and C. So this is a reduced form for Lagrange, and so Lagrange proves, first of all, a thing which is not immediately obvious, that every quadratic form possesses an equivalent form which is reduced, and owing to this reduction process, well, first of all, he proves that given a discriminant D, there are only a finite number of reduced forms of discriminant D. So a fortiori, there is only a finite number of equivalence classes of forms. So counting makes sense in the sense that for every discriminant D, there are infinitely many forms with a discriminant D, but only finitely many classes of equivalence of discriminant D. And so in a sense, the problem is how to
eliminate the superfluous, the reduced forms, which are so if I in every equivalence class I can find at least one reduced form, but not only one. So I have to eliminate, if I want to count the equivalence classes, I have to eliminate all the forms which are equivalent to one of these forms. So how to eliminate, once I have found one reduced form equivalent to the form considered, how can I eliminate all the other forms, reduced forms equivalent to this? So this is the most difficult part of Lagrange's work in this, in Recherche d'Arithmétique. So Lagrange, so he finds an algorithm to select one and only one reduced form for each equivalence class, and Lagrange's algorithm splits into two different methods according to the sign of the discriminant. So if the discriminant is negative, in other words, if the forms are definite, they're positive or negative definite, then Lagrange shows that the only reduced forms, the only reduced forms equivalent to a given one, are, there are only four equivalent forms to this, reduced forms. So this form, or with a minus sign in front of B, or with plus or minus sign and A and C interchanged. So if the discriminant is negative, he proves that for every equivalence class there are only four reduced forms. So this solves the problem. If however, if the discriminant is positive, so if the forms are indefinite, then Lagrange's algorithm is much more complicated, the situation is much more difficult, and can be ultimately reduced to his method of resolution of Bell's equation involving the use of continued fractions. So there is in fact a continuity between Lagrange's theory of continued fractions and Lagrange's algorithm for this problem in the case of indefinite forms. In fact, if you think of Bell's equation, the left-hand side of Bell's equation, x squared minus a y squared, is obviously a quadratic, a reduced and indefinite quadratic forms. So he had to use his algorithm for continuous fractions. All right, I have also prepared a couple of transparencies let me just use a couple of minutes for this. So the two results which cannot be classified among the type of results that I spoke about are, as I said, La démonstration d'un théorème d'arithmétique, which is a paper of 1770, proving the four square theorem, that every positive integer is a sum of at most four squares. So Lagrange uses Euler's identity written over here, which shows that the product of two integers, which can be expressed as sum of four squares, is again an integer of the same type. And this was known by, to Euler. But Lagrange arrives at a complete proof of the theorem with these two steps. So he proves that every prime number dividing, so naturally, because of this multiplicative property, it is enough to, it suffices to prove the theorem for primes. And how to prove this for primes? So the two steps of Lagrange are the following. He proves that every prime number dividing the sum of at most four coprime squares is the sum of at most four squares. And then that every prime number divides an integer which is the sum of at most the three squares, one of which is one. So combining these two steps, he gives a complete proof of the theorem. The the other very interesting result, which is, cannot be classified among continuum fraction theory of Diophantine equations and so on, is proof, the first proof in the mathematical literature of Wilson's theorem, saying that for each prime p, p minus 1 factorial is congruent to minus 1 mod p. And this is interesting. Lagrange was the first to give a complete proof. Wilson didn't know how to prove this theorem, simply conjectured it. And Lagrange's proof is very interesting and is summarized here. Also very elementary and very interesting, also because it is independent of the existence of a primitive root mod p. A primitive root of a prime number p is a generator. It's a generator of the cyclic group z modulo p star. So if you take all the classes modulo p different from zero multiplicatively, this is a cyclic group, and the generator of this group is called primitive root mod p. So using the existence of a primitive root of p, as Euler did later, after reading Lagrange's proof, it is somehow standard how to prove Wilson's theorem. But in fact, this article is 1771, and Euler later on in 1773, 2 years later, building up Lagrange's proof, on Lagrange's proof, gave another proof of Wilson's theorem, but based on the existence of a primitive root mod p. While Lagrange's proof is completely independent, it's very simple. So he starts from the identity that you see over here, x plus 1 times x plus 2 up to p minus 1 is a polynomial where the constant coefficient is, of course, p minus 1 factorial. Then in this identity, he changes x to x plus 1 everywhere, and then multiplies the equation by x plus 1. So x plus 1 becomes x plus 2, x plus 2 becomes x plus 3, and so on, and then you add the factor x plus 1. So you obtain that the product of these is given by this, with the same coefficients as here. Then he multiplies the first identity, this one, by x plus p. He multiplies the first identity by x plus p, so he finds two different, in fact the same, but two different expressions for this polynomial. One is the first one, and then this the second one. Then if you expand the powers of x plus 1 in the first, if you expand the powers of x plus 1 over here, and then you compare coefficients, you obtain that a1, a2, and so on are given by these expressions, where ap minus 1 is p minus 1 factorial, and you have a recurrence for the other coefficients, which is this one. But since for p prime and for any k between 1 and p minus 1, the binomial coefficients p over k is a multiple of p, obviously, is a multiple of p, then by these recurrences you see that a1, a2, up to ap minus 1 are multiples of p, and therefore you obtain that p minus 1, ap minus 1, which is p factorial minus p minus 1 factorial, must be congruent to this, and also congruent to 1 mod p, and this is the proof of Wilson's theorem. All right, thank you very much.
Professor Viola. Are there the questions on this exposition? Or in Lagrange number theory, Professor Crepel?
Je ne suis pas professeur. Est-ce que Lagrange a entièrement travaillé seul ou est-ce qu'il a des relations, des discussions avec d'autres gens à Berlin comme Lambert Beglin qui se sont parmi.
Oui, oui, sans doute, sans doute, avec, premièrement avec D'Alembert. Non, non, Lambert, in fact, because he was German, not French. So let me call D'Alembert as D'Alembert and Lambert as Lambert, because he was German, just to fix something. And in fact, I should call Lagrange Lagrangia to be strictly. But anyway, let's avoid this type of arguments. So he was in correspondence constantly with Euler and also with D'Alembert, with Lambert, with other people, several other people. But as far as I can, as I guess, his results are of his own, really results by Lagrange. Not, I don't know about results real, proved together with other, except perhaps Euler, because he is in such strict correspondence with Euler that you can see the mutual influence between Euler and Lagrange. So there is no doubt that several results in number theory by Euler are influenced by Lagrange's theorems and vice versa. So in this sense, I should say yes, but essentially with Euler, and I don't know about other people.
Other questions? Vous avez bien rappelé les additions d'Euler de Lagrange au volume d'Euler qui a été imprimé, je crois, la première fois en allemand. L'algèbre d'Euler.
Oui, la traduction en français
est de à Lyon, oui.
À Lyon, ça. Et à Lyon de l'année
1713.
1773.
73, oui, c'est ça. Johann Bernoulli. Oui, la traduction a été faite par Johann Bernoulli.
Bien sûr, oui, c'est vrai.
Et c'est dans cet ouvrage qu'on trouve la solution du problème de Fermat pour Troyes. Hein?
Oui.
La démonstration que l'impossibilité d'avoir
la solution. Entre autres, c'est un peu une encyclopédie de toutes sortes de problèmes à l'époque. Donc.
Et vous pouvez trouver le volume de Euler Lagrange dans Mathematica Italiana, le projet du centre de Giorgi, qui va accueillir maintenant presque 500 volumes ouvrages, non? À peu près, et auquel nous vous invitons à collaborer. Merci à tous et au revoir, à demain.